Hello and a very good evening. You're watching the news at 6 on Rajya Sabha television with me, Frank Pereira. Here are the headlines. Rohingyas not refugees as they have not taken asylum in India, says Home Minister Rajnath Singh. Asks why people are objecting to deporting the illegal immigrants when Myanmar is ready to accept them. Prime Minister Narendra Modi pitches for efforts to boost cooperative sector, says that cooperatives should enter new areas like beekeeping to increase farm and rural income. Two civilians killed in grenade attack in Thral area of Pulwama district in Jammu and Kashmir. Many, including policemen, injured. State Minister Naeem Akhtar has a narrow escape. And Hurricane Maria makes landfall in the U.S. territory of Puerto Rico, triggers heavy floods and destroys hundreds of homes across islands in the Caribbean. Well, let's start the bulletin with the latest on the Rohingya crisis. Home Minister Rajnath Singh today reiterated the government's stand on the issue, saying that the Rohingyas were illegal immigrants and not refugees who had applied for asylum in India. Singh also said that India was not violating any international law in deporting the Rohingyas. Meanwhile, in Bangladesh, the stranded refugees claim that they will return to Myanmar only if the country accepts their ethnicity.
Home Minister Rajnath Singh once again underscored that Rohingyas are not refugees who applied for asylum, but are illegal immigrants who will be deported. Addressing a seminar on Thursday organized by the National Human Rights Commission, the Home Minister emphasized that India will not be violating any international law if it deports the Rohingyas because it has not signed the UN Refugees Convention 1951.
Myanmar se Bharat ghusaye. ये रोहिंग्या रिफ्यूजी नहीं है इस सच्चाई को हमें समझना चाहिए रिफ्यूजी स्टेटस प्राप्त करने के लिए एक प्रोसेस होता है और इनमें से किसी ने उस प्रोसीजर को अपनाया नहीं है उस प्रोसीजर का पालन नहीं किया है रोहिंग्या लोगों को भारत से डिपोर्ट करके भारत किसी इंटरनेशनल लॉ का भी उल्लंघन नहीं करेगा क्योंकि वह 1951 UN Refugee Convention ka signatory bhi nahi hai.
Rajnath Singh clarified there's a procedure to get refugee status. He also said the deportation process of Rohingyas is being misunderstood with the non-refoulement principle. Home Minister's statement comes in the backdrop of an NHRC notice to the centre over its plan to deport Rohingyas who live across the nation.
Non-refoulement ka siddhant un logon par lagu hota hai jinhone Bharat mein asylum liya ho. किसी भी रोहिंग्या को भारत में एसाइलम प्राप्त नहीं है और न ही किसी ने इसकी कोई एप्लीकेशन भी आज तक दी है इसलिए ह्यूमन राइट्स का हवाला देकर इलीगल इमिग्रेंट्स को रिफ्यूजी बताने की यह गलती कम से कम नहीं की जानी चाहिए
The NHRC clarified its stand and said that it only brought the issue of Rohingyas on humanitarian grounds and has refused to divulge on the center's stand. Meanwhile, Muslim groups held protests in New Delhi against the government's decision, even as the Supreme Court is all set to hear a challenge to the proposed repatriation. Protesters demanded that the government should at least provide shelter to the 40,000 refugees who fled their homes in Myanmar's Rakhine state after a military crackdown.
हमारी मांग ये है कि हिंदुस्तान जो है वो बर्मा के रिफ्यूजी को पनाह दे दे और हिंदुस्तान में कोई स्पेशल हिंदुस्तान में नहीं आ रहा है इसलिए कि हिंदुस्तान की सरहद बर्मा की सरहद से जहां से मिल रही है तो कुछ लोगों को वहां से जान से मारा जा रहा है उनके हाथ पर ये काटे जा रहे हैं तो अपनी जान बचा के भाग रहे हैं अब उनको ये भी नहीं पता कि हम हिंदुस्तान में जा रहे हैं कि दुबई में जा रहे हैं कि पाकिस्तान में जा रहे हैं तो वो जो बेचारे हिंदुस्तान में जो आ गए हैं उनको कम से कम हिंदुस्तान को चाहिए कि हिंदुस्तान पनाह दे के अपनी वो फराख दिली का ऐलान करे
Rohingya Muslim refugees camping on the Myanmar-Bangladesh border are willing to return to Myanmar if their ethnic identity was accepted and recognized by the government. The Rohingya crisis has drawn international condemnation and raised questions about the commitment of Myanmar's Aung San Suu Kyi to human rights. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
Well, Prime Minister Narendra Modi addressed a cooperative conference in New Delhi today. He said that the cooperatives must explore new areas to double farm income by 2022. He also stressed on the importance to keep the cooperative spirit alive and strengthened.
Addressing a conference in New Delhi on Thursday, Prime Minister Narendra Modi called on the cooperatives to venture into new business areas like beekeeping and seaweed farming. This, he said, will help farmers to double their income by 2022 and boost the rural economy.
2022, हमारे किसानों की आय दोगुना कैसे हो? ऐसी कौन सी चीजों को हम जेड़े? ऐसी कौन सी गलत आदतों को छोड़े ताकि हम हमारे कृषि जगत को भी हमारे ग्रामीण जीवन को आधुनिक भारत के संदर्भ में तैयार करें, विकास की उस दिशा में तैयार करें। अब ये तो संभव नहीं है कि शहर तो आगे बढ़ जाए और गांव को हम पीछे छोड़ दें।
The Prime Minister suggested reversing the trend whereby Indian farmers buy their farm inputs in retail prices and sell their producers at wholesale rates. He said this will end farm distress.
किसान जो खरीदता है वो रिटेल में खरीदता है और जब बेचता है तो होलसेल में बेचता है। ये उल्टा हो सकता है क्या? वो खरीदे होलसेल में और बेचे रिटेल में तो कोई उसको लूट नहीं पाएगा, कोई बिचौलिए उसको काट नहीं खाएंगे।
Lauding the efforts of cooperative movements, the Prime Minister said it's natural for the cooperative sector to grow and shine in India.
अनगिनत क्षेत्र पड़े हैं जिसमें आज भी सहकारिता क्षेत्र के हवा नहीं पहुंची है। जहां पहुंची है वहां स्पर्धा बहुत है। शुगर होगी, स्पर्धा बहुत है। दूध है, स्पर्धा बहुत है। जहां पर कुछ न कुछ है वहां स्पर्धा स्वाभाविक भी है। क्या हम एक नई पीढ़ी को नए स्पिरिट के साथ और खास करके ग्रामीण जीवन में आमूलचूल परिवर्तन लाने के लिए सहकारिता आंदोलन में प्रेरित कर सकते हैं क्या?
The Prime Minister was addressing the birth centenary of Maharashtra-based cooperative leader Lakshman Madhav Rao Inamdar, founder of the Rashtriya Swayam Sevak Sangh's cooperative wing Sahkar Bharati. Inamdar was also a mentor to Narendra Modi in his early years in the RSS. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
Two civilians were killed in Pulwama's Thral town today. This after terrorists detonated two grenades at a busy bus stand in the town. Here's more.
Two civilians were killed in a grenade attack in Thral of Pulwama district in Jammu and Kashmir on Thursday. More than six people, including policemen, were also injured in the attack on a police party stationed near the Thral bus stand. Jammu and Kashmir Minister for Public Works Naeem Akhtar, who was also there at the time of the attack, escaped unhurt.
आंसुबाटा में पता नहीं है लेकिन ग्रेनेड हुआ है, बाद में फायरिंग हुई है फोर्सेस की जानिब से, फिर बहुत सारे जख्मी हुए हैं जबकि दो सिविलियंस की डेथ भी हो गई वहां पे और बहुत सारे सिविलियंस इंजर्ड है।
वहां ग्रेनेड हो गया फिर हमको पता नहीं है वहां फायरिंग के साथ हो गया, फिर ये जख्मी हो गया तो इनको ले गया वहां अस्पताल।
Meanwhile, two separate incidents of cross-border shelling injured three civilians. Pakistani troops targeted Indian border outposts and villages along the international border in Arnia sector of Jammu and in Sambar district. While the injured were taken to the hospital, several houses were damaged and over a dozen cattle were killed in the firing.
The recalcitrant neighbor that we have, it will continue to try and foment trouble here, but our security forces will ensure that the games that are being played from across the border will be not allowed to succeed.
The Indian Army paid tribute to Rifleman Rajesh Khatri, who was also killed by Pakistani troops along the line of control on Wednesday. Khatri had suffered bullet injuries in cross-border firing while he was deployed at a forward post in Jammu and Kashmir's Kiran sector. Bureau report, Rajya Sabha TV.
Well, in a letter to Prime Minister Narendra Modi, Congress President Sonia Gandhi reminded him of the landmark Women's Reservation Bill and asked him to pass the legislation. She asked the Prime Minister to take advantage of his party's majority to get the Women's Reservation Bill passed in the lower house as well. In her letter, Sonia Gandhi wrote that her party supports the legislation, which will be a significant step forward in the empowerment of women. The Women's Reservation Bill envisages 33% reservation for women in the Lok Sabha and all state legislative assemblies. The bill was passed by the Rajya Sabha on March 9, 2010, when the Congress-led UPA was in power. Congress Vice President Rahul Gandhi, who is on a two-week-long tour of the United States, continues his tirade against the government. He has once again raked up the issue of the growing intolerance in India. Addressing a group of NRIs in New York, the Congress Vice President said that most people today are worried about what has happened to India's tradition and of tolerance. Gandhi also invited NRIs to work with his party, saying that they have tremendous knowledge and understanding in different fields which will help his party.
There are forces in our country that are dividing the country. And it is very dangerous for the country. And it ruins our reputation abroad. Many, many people in the Democratic Party, in the Republican Party asked me, what is going on in your country? We always believed that your country worked together. We always believed that your country was peaceful. What is going on in your country? And that is something that we have to fight.
Well, here's a roundup of some other news from across the country and nationwide. Calcutta High Court on Thursday allowed immersion of Durga idols on all days including Mohram in West Bengal. It also directed the West Bengal government to make necessary security arrangements. The bench also directed the state government to put out advertisements giving information about the routes and also for ensuring amity and harmony between the communities. The CBI today arrested former Orissa High Court Judge I.M. Kudusi for helping Prasad Education Trust that's been barred by the government from admitting medical students. The CBI has arrested four others in the MCI Craft case. A day after television journalist Shantanu Bhaumik was beaten to death while covering the clashes in West Tripura, the police imposed Section 144 today. So far, four members of the Indigenous People's Front of Tripura have been arrested by the police. Meanwhile, the Tripura Journalists Union demanded a CBI investigation. Local activists in Tamil Nadu called on the government to conserve the moving sand dunes along the newly laid Rameshwaram Dhanushkodi road to prevent mishaps. According to them, the wall built along the road failed to solve the problem of moving sand dunes and can only be protected by planting trees on both sides of the road. Well, moving on to some business news now. There's good news for India on the economy front. World Bank President Jim Yong Kim has said that India has been growing pretty robustly. Jim Yong Kim also predicted a strong global growth for India this year. He, however, called for more cooperation among the multilateral system, private sector and the governments. Speaking at the Bloomberg Global Business Forum meeting in New York, Kim said Japan, Europe and the US along with India were growing and there was a leveling out in developing countries. World Bank officials also said that India remains the fastest growing major economy in the world. In June, the World Bank predicted a 7.2% growth rate for India this year against 6.8% growth in 2016. But in other news now, Sushma Swaraj's third day of intense diplomatic engagements in New York at the UNGA saw several bilateral and multilateral meetings and events. She attended the SCO and the G4 ministerial meets, besides several bilateral meetings with her counterparts from Brazil, Indonesia, San Marino, Saudi Arabia and Moldova. She also called on Afghanistan President Ashraf Ghani to boost bilateral ties. Here's more.
It was yet another packed day for External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj in New York. Swaraj attended the G4 Foreign Ministers meeting at UNGA, reaffirming the need for early reform of the UN Security Council. India and Brazil are part of the G4 countries, apart from Japan and Germany, which are seeking permanent membership in a reformed UN Security Council. The External Affairs Minister also attended the Shanghai Cooperation Organization meet. Speaking at the SCO meet, Sushma Swaraj said that connectivity with SCO countries is India's priority.
She said that priority-wise, we should have connectivity with SCO countries. And the second priority sector which she mentioned was terrorism. She condemned terrorism and wanted to strengthen cooperation within SCO framework.
She also participated in the informal foreign ministerial meeting of CI nations. Sushma Swaraj called on Afghan President Ashraf Ghani on the sidelines of the UN General Assembly session and discussed issues of mutual concern, situation in the region and bilateral ties.
With Afghanistan, there were basically two distinct themes of discussion. One was on the recently agreed new development partnership. This was agreed during the visit of the Afghan foreign minister to India earlier this month. And the other aspect was on the peace and reconciliation process.
Sushma Swaraj also held bilateral talks with San Marino Finance Minister Nicola Renzi on the sidelines of the UNGA. She also met with Brazil Foreign Minister Aloysio Nunes Ferreira to talk about strengthening strategic partnership between India and Brazil. Swaraj also held talks with her Saudi Arabian counterpart Adil Al Zubair in New York. Sushma Swaraj also held bilateral meetings with Moldova Deputy Prime Minister and Foreign Minister Andrei Galbur and her Indonesian counterpart.
For the bilateral meetings, there were three broad themes. The focus was on expanding bilateral relations, especially in the economic and commercial area. The second was on the meeting of dialogue mechanisms at the earliest, and this came up for discussion during her meetings with different foreign ministers. And the third was her pitch for foreign direct investment under Make in India and other initiatives.
During her week-long stay, Swaraj, leading a high-powered Indian delegation, is scheduled to hold about 20 bilateral and trilateral meetings with leaders attending the session. She will address the UNGA on 23rd September. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
Well, a day after the U.S. threatened to totally destroy North Korea, the Kim Jong-un regime's nuclear program continues to be the most discussed issue at the 72nd session of the United Nations General Assembly. World leaders also expressed their views on the other parts of Donald Trump's debut speech at the U.N. The world body's annual session so far has been dominated by problems of terrorism, refugee crisis, nuclear weapons and the U.N.'s own performance in focus.
Concern over North Korea's missile and nuclear program continues to be at the center stage of the ongoing 72nd session of the United Nations General Assembly. On Wednesday, Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe, while appreciating U.S. President Donald Trump's aggressive stance against the Kim regime in his speech a day before, declared that the time for dialogue with North Korea was over. Abe said that the world has already tried exhaustively to reach a negotiated settlement with North Korea.
かつてなく重大です。眼前に差し迫ったものです。我々が続けてきた軍縮の努力を北朝鮮は
While his stand was backed by many other nations, others like Germany, Sweden and China expressed concern over Trump's bellicose tone and urged dialogue in tandem with sanctions. Meanwhile, amid tensions over North Korea's nuclear and missile tests, dozens of countries signed a treaty to ban nuclear weapons. However, the United States, Britain, France and others boycotted the event at the annual United Nations gathering of world leaders. The Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons will enter into force 90 days after 50 countries have ratified it.
The Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons is the product of increasing concerns over the risk posed by the continued existence of nuclear weapons, including the catastrophic humanitarian and environmental consequences of their use. The treaty is an important step towards the universally held goal of a world free of nuclear weapons.
Meanwhile, another nation expressing disdain over Tuesday's Trump speech was Iran, with President Hassan Rouhani hitting back at U.S. President's criticism of his country and its 2015 nuclear deal. In his debut speech at the United Nations on Tuesday, President Trump had included Iran among a group of rogue regimes and described the nuclear deal as an embarrassment to the United States.
من فکر نمی کنم آمریکا بخواد به این کار دست بزنه ولو اینکه در این زمینه شعار داده شعار میده و شعار خواهد داد ولی اگر تحت هر شرایطی آمریکا از این تعهد خارج بشه.
Another issue that was raised during UNGA session on Wednesday was Myanmar's Rohingya crisis. U.S. Vice President Mike Pence, while speaking at a Security Council meeting on peacekeeping reform, accused the Myanmar military of responding to militant attacks on government outposts with savagery, driving the Rohingyas from their homes. The remarks were the strongest yet from the U.S. government in response to the violence in Myanmar's state of Rakhine that began last month and has forced 4,22,000 Rohingya Muslims into Bangladesh.
And while we welcome Suu Kyi's comments that returning refugees have nothing to fear, the United States renews our call on Burma's security forces to end their violence immediately and support diplomatic efforts for a long-term solution.
This year's UNGA has been dominated by problems of terrorism, refugee crisis, nuclear weapons, and the UN's own performance in focus. Various nations on Wednesday during the session also expressed solidarity with the people of Mexico after a strong earthquake there that killed more than 220 people. Bureau report, Rajya Sabha TV.
Well, rescue and relief work continued in Mexico a day after a massive 7.1 magnitude earthquake killed over 230 people. Rescuers were searching through ruins of over 40 buildings that collapsed in Mexico City alone. More than 50 people were found alive in two of the collapsed buildings. Mexico has also accepted aid from several countries, including Spain, the United States and Japan. Over 90% of electric supply has been restored in the affected areas. The government has also opened up shelters to people whose houses are damaged in the earthquake.
Se reportan como extraviadas en Puebla y en la Ciudad de México. Solo en la Ciudad de México, más de 1,900 personas han recibido atención médica en instalaciones de salud. La mayoría de ellas ya han sido dadas de alta. Se han restablecido los servicios afectados.
Hurricane Maria made landfall in the U.S. territory of Puerto Rico. The storm triggered heavy winds and destroyed hundreds of homes besides knocking out power. Two people were killed as the Category 5 storm left the French territory of Guadalupe. The U.S. National Hurricane Center has warned of large and destructive waves. Puerto Rico's governor told residents to brace for the worst storm of the last century. The government opened 500 shelters that can accommodate 67,000 people. There was also widespread destruction in the independent island of Dominica. Communications to the tropical island of 73,000 people are cut and its airports and ports are closed. The US and British Virgin Islands, which are still struggling to recover from the devastation of Hurricane Irma, are also on alert, along with the Turks and Caicos Islands and parts of the Dominican Republic.
So different. appel en ce moment. En voyant les vagues, c'est la première fois que je vois ça. Depuis que je suis là.
J'ai tout perdu. Ma voiture est écrasée aussi. Et celle-là, c'est une petite voiture que j'avais retapée entièrement. Et puis voilà, elle est foutue.
En tout est tombé par terre. On a, grâce à Dieu, on a encore la maison. Les toits ont bien tenu et voilà, mais la solidarité est là. On va se relever. Moi, c'est mon premier cyclone et ça fait très très peur. C'est
Staying on with international news now, Pakistani Prime Minister Shahid Khaqan Abbasi has said that the Indus water dispute between India and Pakistan can be resolved. Speaking at an event in New York, Abbasi said that water dispute is a legal issue and can be resolved within the context of the agreement. The latest talks between the two countries on the long-standing issue called by the UN that took place last week ended without any agreement. Well, here's a roundup now of some other international news in Global Buzz. Tensions were high in the Spanish region of Catalonia ahead of more planned protests by referendum supporters. Police occupied the region's economy ministry as hundreds of protesters remained outside. Spanish Prime Minister Mariano Rajoy urged separatists to abandon their plans for an October 1st referendum. He asked the region's government to give up its escalation of radicalism and disobedience. A 17-year-old boy was today arrested by British police in connection with a terror attack on a tube train that injured 30 people. With this, the number of arrests in the case goes to 6. The teenager was detained after Scotland Yard Counter-Terrorism Command officers executed a warrant at Thornton Heath area of the city. Police have begun a search of the property where the teenager was arrested under Section 41 of the Terrorism Act. All 6 arrested remain in custody at a South London police station. German Chancellor Angela Merkel looks set to be German Chancellor for the 4th term in the general election next Sunday. Latest opinion polls conducted just days before the election unanimously forecast that Merkel, who has been in power since 2005, will remain at the helm of the next government, irrespective of which coalition will be formed after the election. Well, shifting focus to some sports news. Now, India's top female shuttlers, Sindhu and Saina Nehwal, crashed out of the second round of the Japan Open. While Sindhu lost to Nozomi Okuhara, Saina lost to Carolina Marin. Sindhu, who defeated Okuhara in the final of the Korea Super Series, lost the game 21-18, 21-8 in a match lasting 47 minutes. Sindhu and Okuhara have faced each other 9 times, with Okuhara leading with 5 wins. Meanwhile, Saina Nehwal lasted just 43 minutes against Olympic champion Carolina Marin before crashing out of the tournament. Carolina defeated Saina 21-16, 21-13. It was the second time that Carolina defeated Saina in straight sets. Both have a career record of playing 8 times against each other. They are tied with 4 wins apiece. Well, that's it on this newscast, but do stay tuned for the big picture on the other side of this short break.